What's this California Grape Shakeout all about? It's about understanding what to do, when to do it, how to do it, being informed, what they have prepared. That's what the California Shakeout is about. Exactly at 10:20 this morning, we are going to do an exercise, a practice. And the reason why we do this, and I'm going to explain it in a little bit, but it's 10:20 now. So, earthquake, drop, cover, and hold on. All right, here we are. We survived. But what shall I say? We practice for a reason. When I was a kid, they started judo. And the reason why I did judo was just because it was a fun sport. I thought so. So the first thing we did when we got into class, the teacher told us, okay, start running a little bit and fall forwards and roll. And we did it for days after days. And I'm like, what are we doing? This is not judo. And then he took a little box and he put it in front of it and he says, jump over it and then roll. And he kept doing it, rolling all kinds of directions, back, forwards, sideways. So we did it for weeks and weeks. And I was getting tired. I wanted to play. I wanted to grab on and do some judo, some real sport. But teacher didn't do that for weeks. However, why do I tell you this story? The reason why I tell you this story is because ultimately what happened in the first weeks, that practice that I didn't like and looked so silly, that was, I thought, for nothing, ended up being actually something very valuable in the rest of my life. I eventually learned to drive a motorcycle and did it for many, many years in Holland, many years here in the States. But there were several occasions where I got hit by a car, or I fell actually off my bike for other reasons. I flipped over the handlebars, but every time I was able to roll perfectly off and did not get hurt. And that's the reason for practice. Even if that practice looks so silly, or it looks like, what am I doing? Drop cover under the desk and hold on. Anybody can do that, you think. But there's a couple of key things. By practicing like that, you teach yourself to be aware of your surroundings, to have a clean desk. For example, we cleaned up this morning underneath this desk because I couldn't even fit properly underneath here. So these things, to practice and put it into actual motion, helps you to be prepared for if a major earthquake does happen. And this is what we're doing here at California Seismap. This is what the 20th, this day is about, the California Great Shakeout. It's all about understanding, knowing what to do when disaster strikes by a major earthquake. And this, I and so many of us advise everyone to practice.
This is a test.
Did it hurt good? It is. Drop, cover, and hold on. And this is the drill. Okay, drop, cover, and hold on. Important. We talked about it a little bit, but now you're outside. We're in an unfamiliar area. Very important to understand how to go about it. If you walk maybe outside or you be in a store, you need to always stay alert and stay aware of where do I go and what do I do. Let's say I'm often at the Home Depot. I'm a plumber. I'm somebody that is out and about in big stores with big stuff stacked up above my head. And I am aware. I always do think about it. I need to have a familiar picture in my head that if something happens, I already have predetermined how to go about drop, cover, and hold on. And in a Home Depot, it's very difficult. There's many stacks of big, heavy stuff often above you. And this is what you do. Anytime you come into an unfamiliar area, look around and determine where you go to hold on and to cover. So I have determined to always stack myself in between something that is already heavy. I look for something that is solid, that is heavy, that if I need to tuck myself in between that to hold on and ride the earthquake out. So ultimately, as I said, just to go, you know, I look for an exit if I can, but that's only if an exit is really close by and it's the very beginning of, I know that this is an earthquake. And usually, because outside there is a safety when there is nothing above you, especially in a Home Depot. Now, it's not recommended. Let me make this clear. You know, USGS and many of the big organizations that talk about this, it's never recommended to start running. And I'm also not recommending you to run. Now, if you are just few steps away where you don't have to run as in running over people, whatever, and you can just get yourself outside, I think it's safe. But normally, look for that spot, know this spot, where you go, drop, cover, and hold on. Outside is actually an easy one. Just make sure you're, you know, somewhere away from whatever debris of buildings maybe that could come down and fall on you. So outside is not too difficult. Always make sure that you go to the middle of a street or somewhere where you stay away from buildings or anything that can, you know, look around. Make sure that you're in a safe spot. Now, other places, for example, if you're in an elevator, that's a big one. Don't panic in an elevator. It probably stops.
Looks like a Christmas tree.
But elevators are one of the safest places in a building. So I would not worry in an elevator at all. These elevators do not just fall down. They have all kinds of safety features. So you're in a good spot in an elevator, just don't panic. That's the most important. Ride it out. Wait out until somebody comes, turns that elevator back out on so that you can get out. Escalator. Do not run on an escalator. At any time, don't run. Just allow the escalator to come to a stop, because it will, and then slowly move off the escalator to a safe place. If you have children, if you're a family, and you have young kids, practicing this will definitely help at the time an earthquake happens. Kids in an earthquake might really freak out. They might really be scared. And so if you practice with your children, they learn what to do automatically. You want to know that your kids know what to do, either if they're home, in their room, with you somewhere, in a store, or at school. All right, what do we need to think of after an earthquake? That's important to know too and be focused on. After an earthquake, man needs air, water, and food. I say this in this order because that's the order that's important in. Air is the most important, obviously. If you're in a building that came down around you, there is a lot of, maybe a fire broke out, there is smoke, you need to get out, you need to get to fresh air, that the air is safe. The second part is water. When things are down, for example, we might lose electricity, we might lose our flow of regular water. You need to have a storage and an amount of water somewhere in a place that you can safely get to, that you know that is stored in such a way that it can ride out a big quake. And to get to that place is an important part of it. So if you're far away from that place, far away from home, then make sure that you have water with you, maybe in your car, that maybe in a backpack that you carry always, at least have some water with you. Ultimately, California hasn't seen a huge earthquake, and we need to understand that for a long time. I know there is a crying wolf syndrome or effect. Oh, they're always talking about the big one in California, and it has never happened. Probably won't happen in your lifetime, but it could too. And when it does, you better be prepared. And thus, you need to be aware that yes, California can suffer a catastrophic earthquake close enough by to a major city like San Francisco or Los Angeles or here in Orange County, to the effect that people are severely in trouble if they're not prepared. Make sure you always have water there where your living area is, where your house is, where your place of living is. Food, obviously, food could be a necessity with a major earthquake because it might take 3 days or longer, and you will need food in order to survive properly. So have some cans, have some food stored. So ultimately, on the end of this video, I hope you take two things away from it. One, be prepared, as in knowing where to drop, cover, and hold on. And the other one is to know that you need to have always access after a major quake to your water and your food. Water and food are absolutely a necessity in a major earthquake, to be prepared to that extent that you can survive a minimum of three days. 3 days. So there we go. Communication would be next. Communication is important. You would like to see if your loved ones are safe and if they are okay. So make sure that obviously your phone battery is always charged, or you have an extra charger in your pocket that you can put your phone, connect that, and text. Never start calling anybody during an earthquake and after an earthquake. Never try to call someone. First of all, you'll get very frustrated because you will not get through most likely. We should text. Text messages take so much less bandwidth. And with bandwidth, I mean it takes far less for the text to go through in a system than for the telephone system to deal with your voice. So ultimately, never ever try to call somebody after a major earthquake. Make sure you just text. A text might also not go through right away, but look at your phone. If it didn't go through, try a couple minutes later, try 5 minutes later, try 10 minutes later, try an hour later, try again up again with a text. That is fine. The system will only be longer down if you try to call other loved ones. And I know it can be very scary, very panicky. Just remember this. There again, practice gives you that confidence of knowing what to do and why to do it. If you know ahead of time that if everybody texts, then most likely the system stays way more active and we can stay in communication way more better with our loved ones. Another way for communication is if you have CB, and as you see what I'm unpacking here is it's actually the antenna crazy long and it unfolds itself. Look at this antenna. But why is this antenna so long? Because it will give you further range. So if both parties has one of these Bofang radios, this is actually ham radio, then you can use this on quite a distance, like 10 miles you can reach each other, or longer or more, and with repeaters even further. So this is something that probably survives a major earthquake much more likely than our regular phone system does. And so with this system, I can call my loved ones on a certain frequency you already have programmed in your radio. And then you can reach each other and stay in contact. So it's a funny thing to walk around with maybe, but man, this can really make a difference in time of an emergency. All right, that's about a communication. So thank you. If you support our channel, thank you for being part of California Seismograph. We are always live 24/7 on YouTube. You can find us under CA Seismograph, our actual website. But if you go to YouTube, you can find us. We have been live for over 4.5 years now. We're going on our 50th anniversary. Very excited about that. California Seismograph has many moderators on the channel, but in the chat you can ask questions. So afterwards we'll have a Q&A. So stick around. I'll be live on the site once again, and you can ask all the questions you like to for the next hour. And after that, you can always email us. So thank you for your support. If you're the support by subscribing, thank you for that. Please, if you have not done so yet, so hit the subscribe and the thumbs up. And hit the bell for if you like to get our new videos update. It will come right to you and it lets you know that we have an earthquake that happened. We definitely have an explanation of where it was, the magnitude, the depth, all these things. Information about the earthquake will be on our site at all times. So participating, interested in helping out our site, then go ahead and email us. There's an email that runs on our scrolling bar. Please email us and we are very excited to hear from you. Thank you for joining us today, October the 20th at 10:20. We started with drop, cover and hold on. Practice that. Don't forget, have a great day. We'll speak to you soon again. God bless.